There's 100,000 streets in this city. You don't need to know the route. You give me a time and a place, I give you a 5-minute window. Anything happens in that 5 minutes and I'm yours. No matter what. Anything happens a minute either side of that and you're on your own. Do you understand?
I think that cinema found me, and it kind of came from a possible accident. I'm very dyslexic, so images were my only way of entertainment until I was around 13, because I didn't learn to read until I was 13. And I moved to New York when I was 8 from Denmark, so I didn't really learn to speak English until I was 9-ish. There's something inside you. It's hard to explain. So for a long time, sound and visions were very difficult for me to combine. So images became my main source of seeing the world. And it wasn't until I was 14 when I saw the Texas Chainsaw Massacre in New York, that film found me, because it wasn't that I wanted to be a director or writer or producer. I wanted to do what that film did. The whole film is just a total experience that goes beyond normality, sexuality, and it's just a pure emotional ride of just terror. You know, it has no meaning other than it's an experience. It's very pure in that sense. Same time, I understood the commerciality of it and the potentials and how cinema is also a business that needs to turn around in order to make more movies, because it's an expensive medium. So it's not so much like the obvious, it's more like the whole approach of it and how this became a very singular experience, but also a singular piece of art. I try to be as diverse, because I like all kinds of films. There's everything from Terence Fisher, who was a British director who made a lot of films for Hammer, amongst, but who's a very interesting film director, and I think that very much undervalued in terms of his actually quite technical skills to tell stories.
But I can repair the brain. It's what I've done that counts. I've created a being.
There's a few Fellinis who I very much admire personally, of course, especially La Dolce Vita, which is, you know, probably the greatest film ever made. Some modern films. I love that film Cloverfield. I thought that was just absolutely fantastic. There's a little bit for the midnight section, and there's something for the early morning intellectuals, and there's something for the midday relaxing. Well, my involvement in Planet of the Vampires really came from a meeting in Rome. Because the producer is also a distributor who's still alive, Fulvio Luciano, and he distributes my films in Italy. I asked Fulvio, what are you going to do with Planet of the Vampires? It's such an incredible film. And he was like, I didn't really know. And I said, well, why don't we restore it and like represent it? And he liked the idea. And so, you know, we went back to the original camera negative and restored it in 4K, so an absolutely pristine presentation that premiered at this year's Cannes Classics, which was probably one of the funnest things at this year's Cannes.
Who? Tell me, who did you see, Tiana? Empty faces. Dead faces.
First of all, it's great pop art. It's very entertaining. It's also very campy. It's very colorful. The costumes are just to die for, and it's like pure leather fetish. The music is really good, and very experimental for that time. He even uses electronic music at a very early stage. It's a horror film. It's a science fiction film. In a way, it's the original creation of what is now modern science fiction. I've always shot all my movies in chronologically order because it forces me to instinctually decide everything as much as possible. It's a bit like painting in a way. And also, I don't really like to know where it's going to go. I have an idea, but I'm interested in the process more than the result. And the more process can be instinctual, the more interesting it becomes to me.
Ah, that is the world. What you are doing now is to working for success.
And musically wise, you know, I've been working with Cliff Martinez now on 3 movies. He also did the soundtrack to my wife's documentary, so he's very much part of the family. We met on Drive, and for that there was not a lot of time to make the music, but on the phone films afterwards, like Only God Forgives and Neon Demon, you know, I show him, even like before there's a script, I talk to him about what I would like to do, and also like it's at a place now where it's like, we call it the cliff sections, where it's like we make cut the movie to a certain stage, but to really bring it all together, we know that the music is what's now gonna come in. I'm not a political filmmaker. I don't really have an interest in making a statement. I think that art is so much more interesting when it's up to interpretation, and it also becomes more timeless. On this film, Neon Demon, I felt, well, now it was time to make a teenage horror film for women about a young girl who's 16. So once I get that in my mind, you know, I kind of draw upon my own fetish and desire of what it would be like being a 16-year-old girl, and then, you know, the film starts to evolve. Well, I mean, when you choose your lead, it's very much about finding the best actor for the job. But it also has to be someone that I can mirror myself in, because I am very self-absorbed when I work. And so the protagonists are my alter egos. Clearly, myself and Ryan have a very intimate relationship. I also had that with Mads Mikkelsen. We were starting out together. In terms of just professionally, it's, you know, it's a job being a performer. And I'm an entertainer, and then we find a way to make the best use of each other. Everyone agreeing to like something usually means that it didn't penetrate very deep. Because how are we supposed to all agree on something when people are so goddamn different? Same thing as everyone hating it. But people loving or hating it, that's the essence of creativity. That's why we do what we do. A real human.